Okay, welcome back. So, where we ended last week is that we said we wanted to make an optimized bit array, where in the array class, I don't want to use a full integer for a Boolean, but I want to use only a bit. And we started writing that class, bit array HBB, and basically we finished it. Except the subscript operator. Because what I want to be able to do is I want to do things like I want to set a certain bit to be true, for example, or false. So I want to be able to set things and I want to be able to read things. And this part is easier, the subscript for a const array, we implemented that. And that simply took the index. Divided by the size of the integers in which we store it, and that tells us then which of the words we're using. If we store things in a 32-bit integer and I want to access the index number 5, then it's in the first entry with the 50 index 0. If you want to get 35, then it will be in the second one. And then to get the bit out, I take the index modulo the size of the integer. And I simply right shift it by that, and this is nearly done because here we need to get this, and then we only want to take the rightmost bit and one. So I shifted that the bit I want is the lowest one, and then I do a bit end with a mask here with a one, and I just get that one bit out that I want. And then I ask you, how can we do the non-const version? How can we do a reference that lets me set something? I want to do, for example, a subscript 3 equal true, like here. What can we do? I want to have a pointer to a single bit, right? If I had a bit pointer, then I just use a bit pointer and I use it. But we don't have bit pointers. So what can we do? They ask you to think about it. And you will know about C++. You have all the technical knowledge to tell me the solution now. Who has any idea? No idea. Basically, I already told you the answer. What do we need? We need a kind of bit pointer or a bit reference. So something that references a single bit. Where when I read the value, it reads the value of the bit. But when I write something into it, when I sign something into it, it sets the bit. So we need a bit reference. But there's no built-in bit reference in C++. So what do? We just write one. Right? You can define your own types. You write a class. So that's what we have to do, is we have to write this bit reference class that references a single bit. And before we do that, let's think about it. How do I store a bit reference? How do I store the reference to, for example, the third bit in a certain integer? How do you store a reference to an integer? Simple, a reference, right? How do you store a reference to a certain bit in an integer? What do you need to store it? No idea? Come on, it's easy. Lay. Yes, you store the reference to the integer and you store the bit number. So that's what we have to store. So then the constructor of the class has to take those two numbers and store them. When I want to read it, I need those two numbers and I get the bit out. When I want to write it, I take those numbers and I write things into it. So let's start this. And where we have to do it is that up here, there's this reference which doesn't exist yet. So it's this bit reference. Let's call it just bit reference. And it's a bit reference templated on this type T. So now we have to write this bit reference class. The easiest that I can do is I can actually put it here right into the class as a class member. I can just define it. So I can just define here, or let's do it outside. Template class T, class bitreference. And then we put something public later, but first, privately, we just store. We store namely, so there's the value type, let's go, or storage type, no, we don't. So privately, we just have a T reference. That's the value. And we have an integer, the bit, which bit I'm going to choose. Those are the two things that I need to store. Then what do we need? We need a constructor. And the constructor has to take a reference and a bit position. And I initialize it. So now we can already implement the subscript operator. The subscript operator returns a bit reference, or it's this reference type. Reference type, and it's initialized with a reference to the integer of which I want something. That was the same as before. That's the value at the index divided by the number of bits. Okay, storage type, that's not correct. Storage type times 8. Very simple. Before writing many times storage types times 8, what do? We just introduce a new member. So we go up here, and we have the storage type somewhere, and we are doing a static const int storage, or bits per word is 8 times size of storage type. So we go down here, and all these things is index divided by bits per word, index modulo bits per word. Here, index divided by bits per word. And the bit itself is index modulo bits per word. And we're done in here. Right now, we've implemented the subscript operator. What we've used here is the fundamental theorem of software engineering. You can solve any problem by adding another level of indirection. We just say there's this type reference to which I dispatch it, and I give it the reference to the number and the bit. But now, of course, we have to implement this reference. So now this is done here. Now we have to go up here and we have to implement it. The constructor we have, but then I want to be able to read the value and I want to be able to assign into it. But that's easy. I want to get it out, so I want to change it to a boolean, and we learn soon that this is the operator bool. That's something to convert it to a boolean. So I want to take this and I want to change it to a bool. That's a function called operator bool. Okay, it's const, it doesn't change it. And what does it do? I just have to return a certain bit. So I'm returning value right shift by number of bits, and I'm not sure about the operator precedence, that's why I put it in parentheses and do a bit and with 1. This takes that integer, it shifts it that the bit I want is the lowest one, then I do the bit and that only that bit remains. So I can read it, but I want to be able to write. I want to assign something into it. I want to write this is equal something else. So what do I need for that? I need the assignment operator. And that should return me a reference. So let's say that returns a bit reference. And it's an operator equal. And it takes a bool value, a bool x. It should set it to that value x. Now one part is easy. So I have to do something. And then I just have to return a reference to myself, star this, like with any assignment. So now the only thing we have to do is we have to set that specific bit in the value to either true or false depending on what x is. How do we set a bit? Who has done bit operations in the past? Come on. Somebody must have an idea. Lay. We can an XOR. An XOR of the bit changes the bit's value. So what we can do is we think if we want to set the bit, then we do an OR. If we want to clear the bit, then I have to do an AND with a mask where it's not there. So let's sketch that here on the blackboard. Let's say we have some integer value, or it's in the 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, or something. And what if I want to read a certain value? If I wanted to read the fifth bit, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, the fourth here, then what I'm going to do is I'm taking the whole thing and I'm left shifting it by 4. So then I just get 0, 0, 0, and then was it 1, 0, 1. And then I did the bit AND with 1. That was a bit AND with 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. If I do the bit AND, then I just get a 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1 or 0. What do I do if I want to set a certain bit? Let me say I want to set this first bit here. If you want to set a bit, then what I can do is I take this 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, and I do an OR with 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. I want to do a bit OR with this. I want to do an OR with this. Then I get 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. Then this bit gets set. Okay, so let's implement this next. So here, what we will do is I say if x, so if not x, or if x, if it's true, if I want to set it, okay? If I want to set it, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to write value equal value bit end, and now I want a mask that has a 1 at the bit's position. There's just 1 left shifted by the number of the bit. So this way I'm setting that bit. And else, what if you want to clear it? If I want to clear it, then I have to do a bit AND with something that is 0. So if I take this and I want to clear this bit here, then I take this and I do a bit AND with a mask that is 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1. And that one here gets deleted. Now I end up with 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1. So here I need a mask that has a 0 at the position and a 1 elsewhere. And the way I do that is I take a mask that has a 1 here and I flip all the bits. So for this, I have to do value equal value. Now I have to do a bit AND with, I take first a mask where that one bit is set, and I invert all bits. Take one, I shift it to here, then I invert all bits. Then I get the mask that is all ones except for that point. When I do the bit and, then I clear that bit. So this way now, I can also clear it. And with this, our code is basically done. I think that was all. I have this bit reference class that allows me to set or clear a certain bit in an integer. And that's all that was needed here. Any questions about that? It's nice, elegant, once you think about it. So, but that's also why in the array class, remember when we looked at the array class, I made this strange type test, type def t, value type, type def t, ampersand reference, and the idea was, okay, why do I do that? Why don't I just type value type reference? Anywhere, why do I do a type def for it? And the reason is that sometimes it's not just a simple reference, but it's something more complicated, it's like this bit reference that we did. What it also shows you is that we sometimes want to make an optimized code where I store things more compactly using bits, then I cannot use the simple array class. Because if I use an array of bools, then I will just use one full integer per boolean and I waste space. If I don't care about that, then it's okay. But if you want to save space, like in the panda model, if you want to run it with a billion animals, then you don't want a vector of bools for your the genome. You want something more optimized. You can use the bit array class we wrote, or you can use the bit set class from the standard that we recommend. So now, let me go to my slides. And we want to do a few more things. And the first thing is, we want to talk about some new special members, to conversions and operators. And the first we're going to look at is operators. And we saw already one operator, namely the subscript operator, which was the operator square brackets. But for any operation, like a plus, a minus, a star, a slash, even an arrow operator, even the AND operator, the bitwise AND, the left shift, the right shift, for any of those symbols we have, we can define that for our classes, for our matrix class, our vector class, our animal class, and so on. Like for a matrix class here, I want to write just C equal A plus B instead of C equal sum of A comma B, because that's much more natural for us to understand. But now, how do I define this plus operator for the matrix? The way I define it is that I define a function called operator plus. So when it finds a plus between two things, then it looks for an operator plus. And when it finds the assignment, then it looks for an operator with one equal sign. It looks for the assignment operator. And it looks for that in multiple places. It can either find a function operator plus that takes two matrices, that's a free function that takes two matrices, or the first matrix A could have a member function that's called operator plus and that takes a second matrix. So it can be either the free function that takes two matrices, or it can be a member function of the class that takes a second one. The assignment operator has to be a member class, so it looks for a member function that is called operator the equal, that and that's used to implement the assignment. Here's one first example. We write the point class, and will have many members. Here I want to show just one, namely the plus equal operator. The plus equal must also be a member function, like the assignment operator. So here I want to be able to write b plus equals c, and that's why I write the operator plus equal. It takes a const point reference. Why does it take a reference? Why doesn't it copy it? If you copy it, I have to copy two doubles. Have to pass in two doubles. When I pass in a reference, it just passes a point and that is smaller and shorter. Why const? Simply because it should not change the right-hand side. And you always put in const whenever possible. The member function itself is not a const member function, simply because it does change the object. And then I just do the x plus equal the right-hand side dot x and y plus equal the right-hand side dot y. And I return star this, like any assignment should always return reference to itself, so that you can write a equal b equal c or a plus equal b plus equal c and so on. So that's easy now. We've done the plus equal. But we don't want to do only a plus equal b. We also want to do a plus b. And those operators are best implemented as a free function because that shows more that the two sides, left and right, are symmetric. So it's best that we do a free function. And the first way is we can just do the operator plus function that takes two references to two points. It creates a new point result where I add up the x and the y coordinates, and then it returns the result. But this is not nice. The reason why I don't like this is that I've duplicated effort. I implemented a plus equal where I showed how to add it, and now I'm implementing a plus where I'm also adding it. I'm doing things twice. The first thing is I've typed too much. The second thing is maybe I define the plus that it multiplies the x and y values, and the plus equal that it subtracts them, and it's not consistent. Maybe that's a bug, maybe that's what I want. But the best is it should be elegant, it should be consistent and simple. And so the good way is that we simply reuse what we have. And we reuse the plus equal. And what I'm doing is I make a copy of the left-hand side, and then I use plus equal. So I just return x plus equal y. Take x as a copy and add y with the plus equal operator, then that I return. How to make the copy? I could either make the copy be explicitly. What's easier here is I just pass in x by value, point x instead of point reference. That makes a copy of x, then use the plus equal operator to add it, and that's what I return. So any plus operator should always just look like this. It should be that simple. That's because we can always reuse the plus equal. You first write the plus equal and then you reuse it for the plus. Same for the minus, the multiplies, divides, and so on. But now I told you when it's a symmetric operator like the plus, where the left and right side are equal, then we should take the free function. When it's something asymmetric like the plus equal and so on, those we make a member function. Now think about what if we want to print something. You know, stdc out left shift operator free, that prints the integer 3. We can use that for our class by just implementing a left shift operator for the stream and the class. One way of doing is I could do it as a member function. I could just add a left shift operator member function to the stdio_stream class. Well, I can't because that's part of the standard. So to extend it here, I need to make that a free function. And what I have to do to have a function to print my point is I have to implement the operator left shift of the OSTRIM reference and my point. Here it is. And I print, for example, parenthesis open, p dot x, then a comma, then the y. I close the parenthesis, and that prints my point. And then I return a reference to the stream. Again, for the same reason that I returned a reference to the stream to the object in the assignment, because I want to be able to chain it. I want to print the point is. And there I want to have the next left shift. So the return value of this first thing should be, again, a reference to a stream that I put in the point, that returns a reference to the stream that I put in the end line, and so on. So that's how you can print things. And the same for the reading from an I stream like cin. That's just the right-shift operator from cin. It's a bit more tricky for the plus plus and minus minus operators. And the reason is there are two of them, right? We have plus plus a and we have a plus plus. We have minus minus c and c minus minus. So we have an operator plus plus, and the operator plus plus implements the prefix, the plus plus a. And there's the const version as well that we could do. This can either be, So this can either be a member function or it can be a free function. But now what about the postfix? So the prefix plus plus a, we called the operator plus plus. What do we do with the postfix? Okay, one way of doing it is we could define one as the operator plus plus and the other as the plus plus operator. Why is that not a good idea? This is a very bad idea because it is very hard for the compiler to parse that. How does the compiler know that there's a function name coming or some symbol name? It knows there's a function name coming because a function has to start with a letter. Main or f or foo or bar and so on. You can't have a function b called free e. Or you can't have a function called plus minus star hello. Because the plus thinks there will be an expression coming now. And that's why the functions have to start with a letter. So it's called operator plus plus. And we don't want to make it hard and change the syntax just to implement this postfix operator. And so what the standards committee decided was to just have a second operator plus plus that takes an extra dummy int argument. It's not used. It's just there's an operator plus plus as the member function that takes an int. That's not used. It's never passed even. Or the free function that takes the reference and then an int. This extra int argument is there just to make sure that there can be two different functions, one with the int, one without. So you have to know the one without it is the prefix, the one with it is the postfix, and you should implement both, or the people can't use either, can't use both. Now think about how would you implement such a plus plus operator. Let's say I want to implement the plus plus operator for my bit reference class that we did before. The prefix is easy. I increment it and then I just return a reference to the new value. But the postfix, the A plus plus, is harder to implement. Because I have to increment it and then have to return the old value. So first I have to make a copy of it to keep it, increment it, and then I return the copy of the old value. And that tells you why the postfix A++ is actually more effort than the prefix. Because for the postfix one, you have to keep the old value around. And that's why it's the prefix one, which is the easy one, the one that you should use if possible, that has the simple name, and the postfix one, the uglier one, that has the extra int. The next thing to mention is the assignment. Sometimes something might look like an assignment, but isn't. When you write just B equal A, that's an assignment. But when I have the declaration A, B equal A, like int x equal 3 or matrix A equal and then something, that uses the copy constructor. Both when you write it with the parentheses or when you write it with the equal, that's not an assignment, that's the copy constructor. The reason is that in this statement, we are creating the object. We're not creating the object and then assigning it to it. No, we're creating it with that value. So although it might look like an assignment, it's actually the copy construction. Yes. Yeah.
Why do we use a const reference as the return type for the prefix and a non-const and with the postfix, we don't use a const reference for the return type?
That's a good question. A const reference to what do you want to return? The postfix has to return the old value. So for the prefix, I can just return a const reference to myself because it's the object after I've updated it. I increase it and then I return it as a reference. That's fine. The postfix has to make a copy of the value. And then it can make this copy in a local temporary variable. It returns a reference to it, but the moment I exit the function, that value gets deleted. So I have to return a copy. I could create it with new on the heap, return a reference to that, but then it never gets cleaned up. But this is exactly why I prefer the prefix, because the postfix needs to make a copy. If you don't use the value, the compiler might optimize it away. In the prefix, I just never need to make a copy. Okay. Now, the next we had are the conversion operators. I want to convert something of type A into type B. For example, I want to create an A, and then I want to assign that into a B. I want to make a B from it. There are two ways. The first is I can make a constructor of B that takes an A. I can make a constructor of a matrix that takes a vector and then makes just the color matrix, a vector. Or I can delegate it to the class A, that the class A has a function to convert it to B. We did that for the bit reference where we had a function to convert it to a Boolean. That's called the operator B in this case, like we had the operator bool. The operator bool returns a bool, for example, the operator B here makes a B object from A. These are operators whose name is just the operator and then the type. There's no return value. There's no return type specified here. It returns the B, but you don't have to specify it because obviously the operator B that creates a B will return a B. There's no reason to specify it because what it returns has to be a B. You don't have to write B operator B. Or we didn't have to write there, here in the bit array, we didn't have to write bool operator bool because it's obvious that this returns a bool. So Some conversions for the built-ins, like from a character to an int, to an unsigned integer, to a signed integer, from a shortened int to a long, or from a float to a double, or an int to a double, are done automatically by the compiler. Like you can write double x equal 4, though the 4 is an integer, it gets converted by the compiler into the double value 4.0. For your types, you have to write the conversion operators yourself. Then, the subscript operator we had for the array class, that's an operator that can take only a single argument because there can only be a single index. You'll need to write always the const version and the non-const one, but we saw that already in the array example. But next, yes, we did a reference class, a bit reference. We might also want to do a bit pointer class. What if we want to take an address of this bit reference and I want to have a pointer to a bit? I can write a class that's a pointer to a bit, right? We take that and we make it a bit pointer. Now that has to be able to be used like a pointer. So I want to be able to write star p to dereference my bit pointer and then have something into that gives me a bit reference. And I want to be able to write, for example, p arrow some member if that's a class. So if I have some type of special smart pointer, it might be a pointer that actually checks whether it's valid or not. And if it's not valid, it tells you a nice message instead of crashing. So you might want to write some pointer type object. And the pointer, I need the star operator and I need the arrow operator. And the star operator should return a pointer value. So that should return an actual pointer. And the arrow operator should return a reference. Like here I have a class P that should be some kind of smart pointer to doubles. The star operator returns the pointer value. The arrow operator returns the pointer value. The star operator returns a reference to whatever it points to. So I need the operator arrow and the operator star. And then I can make a pointer class. So we made now classes for references. We made classes for pointers. We made classes for arrays. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to make classes for functions. We're going to write an object that behaves like a function. Why is that useful? Let's say we have some potential object, potential v and the distance. I just want to print the potential at some distance. I can either make that as a function, but what if it needs some parameters? Then it's not easy as a function if you want to change those parameters. And so I can make a class now that can do more than just a function. So I can write a class potential here that should act like a function. A function is v function call of distance, v of distance. That's the operator parenthesis, the function call operator. So to implement this v of distance, I'm implementing the operator parenthesis, the function call operator, and that takes double, and in this case it just return 1 over d. Don't get confused by the fact that you have two sets of parentheses here. The first one is just the name, operator function call. So that way I can make functions. So we had pointer classes, we had reference classes, we could have array classes, and we can do many things. But we can even specialize things. And we had that for the array class, right? We wrote the array class in general, and then we wrote a bit array That was fast if you wanted to stay bools because I use each and every single bit. I wrote the array class and then I wrote another class bitArray. But that's not nice. It's not nice because I have to remember if the type is a bool, I should use bitArray instead of array. So it's not very generic. I have to know what the type is. I could just say, forget it. I just want to have one class array, and yes, it wastes space, but I don't care. Ideally, I want to have both. What I want to have is that the array of T is like the standard array, except for bool, I have a special version. I want to change it, and that's what I can do. I first write the generic version array that we had, and then I'm writing a new version array of bool. So I'm writing here this class array of bool. It's templated, but now there's no free template parameter. So it's just template sharp brackets, no parameter, because the bool is specified array of bool, and there I'm writing the optimized version. If I now use an array of int, use the first one. If you write an array of double, use the first one. If you write an array of matrix, use the first one. If you write an array of bool, finds there's a specialized version, that's what I use. That's called template specialization. This is a useful trick that will help us solve some problems that we had for the last months. Then it will help us solve the problem, what is the minimum of an int and a double? It will help us solve the problem, what if I take an array of t and an array of t and I add them is easy, it gives me an array of t. But what if you want to add an array of ints to an array of double? What should the return type be? I can just take the array of t and an array of u. But what should the return type be? Should it be T? Should it be U? Should it be something else? The ugly version we had for the min was we added a third template parameter, which was the return value. But that's ugly here. If for the plus you have to write operator plus sharp parenthesis double, and no, we don't want that. For the plus, we can't really do that. So what you want to do is we want to calculate with types. And we're going to use the same trick that we used before, namely the fundamental theorem of software engineering. You can solve any problem just by delegating. So what we're going to do is, the way I solve this problem is, I just postulate that somebody nice has written for me some class called SumType. And the SumType class takes a type T and a type U. And it has a member, which is nicely called type, that gives me the appropriate type to store the sum of a T and a U. So I'm just going to assume that, we'll have to write that later, but for now I'm going to assume that this sum type exists. So I can write my operator plus, and the return value is just an array of this sum type of T and U colon colon type. There's some class sum type that is templated on T and U that has this magic type member that gives me the right type. And that way the problem is solved. What is this type name thing here? This type name thing here is needed because the compiler needs to know that what's coming here is a type. This type is not just some function or a data member, but a type member. And because it can't know that without knowing the T and U, I have to help it, I have to write type name in front. So for any type member that referred to from inside template code, you have to write type name in front. Next, we have to implement this, some type. Because you don't know that nice person who gave you the type, but you'll have to write it yourself. So, first, we make the general template. Template class, T class, U class, some type. And that should have a member called type. But then we'll be back to the same problem that I just don't know what is the sum of T and U. So I just leave it empty. Curly brace is open and closed. I don't define a member type. What happens now if I run my code and compile it? It will just give me a compiler error that some type of double comma int is not defined. That's a useful message because it tells me that I need a some type of double and int. But for some cases I know it. When both types are the same, then I know what it is. If it's T and T, if the two types are the same, then the sum type is a T. So I can write a specialization that the sum type of T comma T, when it's the same type, that's easy, there, type is just T. So now at least I can add an array of int and an array of int. Next I try an array of float and then the array of double, and it will not compile because for float and double, that's the general template. Boom, there's no type member because I just don't know it. But now I can again use specialization and I define a fully specialized one of double and float. So I write template, empty list, struct some type of double and float. And in this case, I know it manually. It's a double. So I type the double type. Float and double is also double, float and int, int and float, int and long, and so on. And for all types that I want to use, I just define the specialized version of the template class. Why do you struct here instead of class? Remember, structs and classes are the same. Just in a struct, all members are public by default. And here when I write class instead of struct, then I have to write public colon inside. It's easier to save that by writing struct. But these are just specializations of the template class, that if the one type is a float and the other type is an int, then it finds this one here, and it knows the answer should be a float. And the same trick can be used for the minimum function and maximum function. The same trick can be used for the statistics class we wrote. Remember, the templated version worked well for floating point numbers, but not for integer numbers, because the mean value of integers is not an integer, but a floating point number. So we can use traits also for that. Now, how should you write traits? When C++ started, then one wrote just some huge classes that had many members. And one example, one horrible example of this is the numeric limits class that we've seen before. That's just a big struct that has about 20 different members. Is specialized, is integer, there's an epsilon function, a min function, a max function, and so on. It's a huge, heavy blob of many different things. And this is ugly. Why is it ugly? This is like a function that returns 20 values. It's much nicer to have a function return just a single value. And so in the new standard, now people learn that actually one should write these traits like functions, and they made the following convention, that if you have such a traits class, it's called, that calculates a type, then it should be a simple class that has only a member called type. The type member should return it. The type name, like our sum type struct, had a type member that was the sum. If something returns a value, like is this type an integer, we write the struct, is integral, and in general it will be false. So I write template class T, struct is integral, that has only a member called value, and that is set to false in general, because in general something will not be an integer. But for the integers I have to specialize it, so I write something, is integral of int, that sets it to true, is integral of long and short and char and unsigned int, unsigned long, unsigned short, unsigned char and signed char sets it to true. Another application. We had this statistics class and we have the same problem we had there also for the case of the function average that calculates the average of values in an array. We have a long loop through the array. I just sum up the values and then I return the sum divided by the size. But if the type t is an integer, I add a 1 plus 4 plus 3 is 8 divided by 3 is 2. That's not what I want, right? For floating point numbers, it's fine. For integer numbers, I don't want the average rounded to an integer, but I want want it as a double. And so what do we do here? We cannot just return it as a t, but I want to return it as the new type, which is the appropriate type for the average of values of t. So I'm going to define such a traits class with the name the average type. And I'm going to use that. So I'm going to use the average type of t colon colon type. And what is the type here? In general, it will just be the type itself. For complex numbers, it's a complex. For real numbers, it's real. For double, it's a double. Float is a float. Long double is a long double. Complex float is complex float. And only for the integral types, I have to specialize it by writing a version of the average type of int, which says that the type is a double. And the same for long, for short, and so on. The reason why I don't make a break today is that we've switched back to winter time. The US hasn't, so times are shifted off a bit, and I just go through it that they don't go too long there, and we will get to the end here at quarter past the hour today. Is that okay? Good. So there's still something that's not nice here. Because in all these cases, I now always had to manually specialize this trait for every integer type. Or for the sum type, for all pairs of floating point types. The integer types. I might have 8 integer types, so I have to write this 8 times. Boom, 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 boom. For the sum types, I have 8 integer types, I might have 3 floating point types and 3 complex types, so I might have 14 types. That means I have 14 squared combinations. I have hundreds of combinations. And I can now just copy and paste it. Do you like that? No, because I told you should never copy and paste the same thing. So we could use macros to help it. But no, there's something much more elegant because I can actually try to compute it. So how can I compute, for example, the average type? And the average type, so here's the solution of how I can actually write something that computes what is the appropriate average type. And what I'm going to use is I'm going to use the numeric limits class from the standard library. The std numeric limits class has a member is integer for all of the built-in types, and that is true if it's an integer, and it's false otherwise. But it's set only if it's a built-in type, and that means it's set only if the specialized member is actually set to true. So here's how I can calculate what the return type is. The average type is if numeric limits of the type is specialized is false, then it's something general, and then the average type should just be the type itself. But if the numeric limit of T is specialized is set to true, then it's a built-in type. Then I check the numeric limit of T is integer. If that is true, then I know it's an integer and the average type should be double. If it's false, then I know it's not an integer, and then it's the type itself. So now, how do we actually implement this? And the way I implement it is, again, by delegation. First, I make the decision, is the numeric limit of T specialized true or false? And based on that, I calculate something. So I'm going to introduce a class helper1 that is templated on the type and the Boolean. And the general version just gives me the type itself. That's helper1 here. Template class D, bool F, because I can template classes on either types or pointers or on the integer values. So I have a class D and a bool F. And the helper1 class just does type the T type. So that's for a general thing, that if I have just this, then the type name, the name up there in the second line is just the type T. So now I'm going to specialize it though, partially. Namely, if that is specialized is true, then I know it's something else. So now I'm going to write a partially specialized version of helper1 here, where the Boolean is fixed to true and is templated only on T. And in this case, I now want to decide by the delegating to a new class that I call helper2 here, that also takes the type and the Boolean, whether it's an integer or not. So I'm just going to forward it to that type. And then here again, the general one, template class T bool F, the helper2 is just typed F T type. The average type is the type T itself. But, again, specialized, if is integer is true, then I know it's an integer, and then the type should be a double. So what happens now in the compiler when you call that with a matrix? When you call it with a matrix of double, it goes in up there, T is a matrix of double, and the type here is just the helper1 of matrix of double and numeric limits is specialized for the double, which is false. It's false, so it takes the helper1, the general template, and the type is just my matrix of double. What if I pass in a double for the type T? In this case, numeric limits of doubly specialized is true. So it picks the second one, the one where helper1 has the value true. And then it passes it on to helper2 of the type and whether there it's an integer. It's not an integer, so that is false. Then it takes the general one and the type is T, the double. But if you called it with an integer, then it goes through, and for the integer, the numeric limits of T is integer is true. Now it picks that version of the class, and the type is a double. So this way we are calculating it, and I admit it's a pretty ugly code, but it allows you to calculate with types and their properties at compile time by writing these helper classes. Now you can use the same for doing the sum type, the minimum type. You can write beautiful such meta functions, they're called, that calculate the right type for integer plus double and so on. This is nice, this is beautiful. Once you understand it, it's totally ugly and horrible for now. I want you to look at that over the weekend and study it and ask questions. Then in the last week of the course, I'm going to tell you about the new C++ standard, that C++ 11, that has beautiful functions to do that same thing in one line. Because people use it so often, it's so ugly that they help us in the future. But first you have to understand that since that's a very useful general method. So now, that was enough for that. Let's go to something simple that you all know. You know about the Simpson integrator that you all wrote, right? Who doesn't do the homeworks? You all do, it's good. So here I have a simpler one that does the rectangle rule instead of the Simpson rule. The first version just took a function pointer. No, the first version was just the main program. The first version of the library then took a function pointer, like it here. Then we want to make it generic now. And so we can even template it. We can template it on the type of function, and we can template it on the type for the boundaries. So write template class T class F. And I pass a function pointer in F, and I pass the boundaries A and B. That I can use with double, with long double, with float. I could try it with int, it will not make much sense. But with double, float and long double, it works. And I can just call it, I have my function func here. That's just x times the sine of x, and I can call it with that function pointer. But now let's think about a function that takes two parameters. I have a function f of x and lambda, that's exponential of minus lambda x. I want to integrate it over x for a specific value of lambda. Then I cannot use it with the integrate template. Why can't I use it? Because this template here calls it as f of x. It wants a one parameter function. Here I have a function f of x and lambda. I can't call that just with an x. So how can I do that? There's a first solution that's ugly. I make the lambda a global variable. And I set that first to lambda equal 1, and then I call the function f. That's ugly. The elegant version is I make a function object. Remember, I just told you before that we can implement the operator function call, parenthesis operator, that lets you use an object like a function. So here we're going to do that. We're going to write a class myfunc that implements this function, and it has a function call operator that just takes one argument, namely the x, and returns exponential of minus lambda x. Where does it get the lambda from? The lambda value we can store inside the function as a member. So I have a data member const double lambda where I store the value of lambda, and I set that value in the constructor. So I have a constructor for my func that takes the lambda value. To use it now, I create it with my value of lambda, 3.5, and then I can use that in the integrate template I had and integrate the function with two parameters where I fixed one. And one exercise will be for you to implement your Simpson so that it uses function objects. Any questions about this part? If not, then I want to start with a bit of the next lecture. Unless you want to stop now because it was too much and too hard. If you don't hear any complaints, then I'll just go on. So now there's the chance to ask questions. We do something simple. Most of you who are from the CSE had a class in the data structures and the algorithms. The others that may not have. So I want to take a quick introduction into that. And the first thing we're going to do is complexity. For any operation I want to do on a data structure like a vector or a matrix, or for any operation I do like searching or sorting, I always want to know how does the time to solve something scale with the problem size. And we can look at the worst case, we can look at the best case, the average case, the amortized case, the typical case. There are many, many questions. Worst case is usually easy to do. The average case might be much harder. And what we use for that is the big O notation. Is there anybody here who has not seen it? Nobody, it seems. It just means that for big enough problems, the time it needs or the memory it needs is bounded by constant times that function. Because it's bounded by that, I only need to mention the worst scaling parts. So if something goes like n squared plus n cubed, I only need to keep the n cubed, and the n squared I can drop, because the n squared plus n cubed can be bounded by constant times n cubed. The constants I can drop as well. There's also the big omega for the best case. And if worst case and best case scale the same, then one can use the big theta. Why do we want to know that? That's what I want to show you here. Let's assume we have an algorithm that takes one operation, or it takes log n, or n log n squared, n cubed, or 2 to the n. And they can do 1 billion operations per second. If the complexity is 1, if it's constant, and if the prefactor is 1, then it will always take just 1 nanosecond. No matter how big, it's just 1. Done. If it's log n, then for 10 it's 3 nanoseconds, for a million it's 20 nanoseconds, it's still very, very fast. So these are very fast algorithms. For a billion, it might be a bit longer, but it's not much. You can do that on trillions and more. If it's linear, then for a million you reach a millisecond, for a billion you reach a second, for a trillion you reach 20 minutes. It's still okay. N log n slows down by another factor of 20 for a million, but it's still fast. For a billion it's about 30 seconds, half a minute, that's still okay. When you go to n squared, it starts to hurt. An n squared algorithm, for size 1, takes 1 nanosecond. For 10, it's 100. For a million, it takes 10 to the 12 seconds, which is about 17 million. For a billion, it really hurts, because for a billion, it will be of the order of years. So n squared gets already hard. But there are worse methods like matrix multiplication, n cubed. For 10 it's a microsecond, for 100 a millisecond, for 1,000 it's a second, for 10,000 we are at 15 minutes, for 100,000 we are at 2 weeks, for a million we are at 30 years, for 10 million we are millennia. So you really need to know how it works. N squared does the third, n cubed is horrible, and exponential. Okay, we can go to 10 and it's a microsecond, we go to 100 and it's longer than the age of the universe. Exponential is really hard. But even then the n to the 3 hertz and n to the 5 is basically as bad as the exponential. So it's very important that you know if there's in your code anything that scales exponentially, then you just know it's a disaster. Sometimes there's no way around, okay, but you have to at least know, but if it can be avoided, you should avoid it. Same with n cubed or n squared algorithm, if possible avoid it, but first you have to know about it. And now let's assume the same with one of the fastest machines in the world that runs at about 10 PET operations a second. Let's assume it's just perfectly parallel. Then with n and so on, it's milliseconds, microseconds, very fast, and log n is fast, but n squared, when I get to a big problem size of 10 to the 12, is suddenly 3 years. N cubed is the age of the universe, or more on the fastest machines in the world when I go to bigger problems. While n log n is still only milliseconds at most. So this really matters. And thus I now want to ask you, if I give you two algorithms, which one would you pick? And now I mean, and these are trick questions, but I still want to ask you, if one algorithm is O of log n and the other is O of n, what do you pick? A O of log n, yes. If one is O of log n and the other is n nanoseconds, which one do you pick? B or A? B or A? A, because it's O log n. But what if I tell you it is 1 trillion years times log n? O of log n is just some constants that I don't know. Okay, so if I don't tell you the constant, then you just can't decide. So what this means, and that's the trick here, is just if you don't know about constant, then yes, it's clear you pick the log n one. But to really decide, you have to know the constants when n is not too big. If n is huge, then I know it's the log n one, no matter what the prefactor is, because at some point it will win. But what if n is a million, or 10, or 5? Then it might be better choosing a linear one, the n one, if the constant is small for that one. So let this guide you for large problems. But for small ones, you will have to time it or know the constants in front. So that's why here, basically, you can only decide in the first one. And down here, you can just plug in numbers. So log n versus n is clear. Log n is always smaller. Log n versus 1,000 n is clear. Log n is always smaller. 1,000 log n versus n, you can calculate where is the crossover point. For small n, the n will be better. For large n, the 1,000 log n. So for small problems, you might need to know a bit more or try both algorithms. And now, let's look at some examples. What's the complexity of this code? N? Constant? What's the complexity here? Okay, but so, it's a trick question. It's the complexity is a function of the problem size. How many numbers I put in. I can't tell you because this has no problem size. Right? So, ill-defined. Makes no sense. That's why there's lots of white space that you can write here. It makes no sense because it's a function of the problem size. So let's make it better. Here I have a loop where I read a number n. Now I have a problem size. Now make a loop where I print the squares of all the numbers up to n. What's the complexity? N is linear. Make another one where I have two loops. Okay, one, so where I calculate the partial sums in a stupid way, I make a loop up to n, and then inside I always sum up to that value, and then I print the partial sums. What's the complexity of this code? What's the complexity? N squared, because the constants and linear terms, terms you drop, it's quadratic, n squared. You can make it better and go to linear by just adding always the current value to the current sum. Now here, now I want to go for best case and worst case. In the first part, I read n, then I allocate an array of n numbers, and then I read n numbers from the input. That's linear complexity, right? And in the second part, I'm reading one more number, and I want to look, is that number in my array? And if yes, I print the index. What is the best case? What is worst case? What is average case?
Best case is constant 1, and worst case is linear.
Best case is 1 because it's the first value, the defined, right? Worst case is n, linear, because in the worst case, the number is not even in there. Average case is linear because if you choose a random number, it will just not be in the area, and the loop will run to the end. Now, that's, I think, one of the, we still have time. Now, how do you add an element to the end of an array? What's the complexity of that? If you have allocated an array of 10 numbers and you want to increase it to 11, you can't just write an 11th number because the size is not that big. So I need to allocate a new array with 11 entries. Then I need to copy over the old entries, delete the array, and write one more. Look at the resize function we had in the array class. We made a new one of the size and we copied over. So that is linear complexity. But there's a... There's something wrong with the function. There's an equation that should be written down there that doesn't show up because of some problems in there. I can open it in PowerPoint. That will help me. But I don't show up. Here we see the equation. These are not going to display it because then it messes up all of the broadcasting. So the smart way is the following. I think I have that further down in a nice way. Let me just show that. So here's the smart way. The smart way is that when I add another value, let's say I have an array of four entries, A, B, C, and D, and I want to add a fifth one. The stupid way is just adding one and I copy everything. The smart way is I immediately double the size. I go to four more. Then I copy it once, and the next three times I can just insert it. And only when I add the ninth one, then I have to again double it in size. I copy it over once, and then I can add more. So what is the complexity of this? The complexity, if I always double it in size, will be sometimes it's linear, but other times it is constant. So here, once is linear, it's 4, and then 3 times is constant. Then once it costs 8, then 7 times it's constant. Then once it costs 16, and 15 times is constant. So on the average, the amortized, it will cost me only constant. Because once it costs order n, and with n minus time minus, one times is constant, and so I can just add it to the end. And sometimes it's linear, but most of the time it's constant. And so when I do it many times, then it's constant. And that's what we call amortized n, because sometimes, constant, because sometimes it might be large, but most of the time when I do it many times, it will be constant. Okay. So what we're going to learn about next week will be the standard template plate library, which is part of the C++ standard. That's a beautiful case of generic programming. That was the library through which generic programming was actually invented, and it shows you how to make a good generic library with templates. And it will have many components in there. I really have to show that in PowerPoint. And here we have a nice figure. That namely. So it has many things. It has data sequences, has containers, it has the vector class like an array, a linked list class, it has tree-like class in the map and the set, it has queues and stacks and decks, it has priority queues, it has function objects, it has predicates, things that are less than great and equal, not equal, and so on. It has many, many, many components that beautifully work together. And that's what we're going to learn about next week. So let me stop here and ask about questions. And we had a challenge for a few years that I showed you the average type trait that I did, but we didn't do the sum type. The student who gives me a beautiful solution of a sum type where I don't have to manually specify things gets a prize. The price was typically a bar of chocolate, Swiss chocolate.